after him, we'll hear from PIDS Senior Research Fellow Roehlano Briones, who will talk about the long-term growth prospects for the Philippine economy. But before we start with the presentations, may we request our President, Dr. Celia Reyes, for the opening remarks.
Regularly now in our seminars. So we're going to discuss very relevant, very important and relevant topics today, and we'd like to thank United Nations Economic and Social Commission for Asia and the Pacific, or UNESCAP, for co-organizing this seminar with PIDS, and we're very privileged to have with us today one of their experts, Dr. Zheng Jian. So for this afternoon, as Wang said, we have two presenters. Of course, we have our international expert and also our in-house expert from PIDS. So Mr. our expert from UNESCAP will be sharing highlights of the UNESCAP's Economic and Social Survey of Asia and the Pacific 2018 report. And he will provide us an overview of the economic performance of developing countries in the region, and the challenges that they continue to face as they try to sustain and improve their gains. It will also provide us analysis and policy options that can lead to resilient, inclusive, and sustainable economies. And of course, to give us a local context, I'm sure everybody knows Dr. Roehlano Briones, who will talk about the long-term growth prospects for the Philippine economy. Specifically, his presentation will tackle the role of productivity to reach the Philippine Development Plan targets. And he'll be talking about the policies or measures that will be needed to accelerate productivity growth. And we're hoping that these two presentations will highlight the importance of policies in achieving long-term economic growth and reducing negative impacts such as inequality. This is where think tanks like PIDS come into play. It's our primary role to come up with evidence-based policy recommendations that are feasible and will promote the well-being of the people. So today, this afternoon, I encourage all of you to actively participate in the open forum later on so we can identify policy measures that will be critical to sustaining inclusive growth. So once again, thank you.
Much for that, Dr. Reyes. Now we are ready to listen to Dr. Zian's presentation.
Good afternoon, everyone. So it's really my pleasure to come to the Philippines. This is my second time visiting Manila, and I do like the city and also your journey. I tried last time. Like great thanks to PIDS for agreeing to host this joint seminar with us. And I think in our communication that I told the colleagues from PIDS that the purpose of this seminar is not only to present what we have done in our research, but more importantly is to have an interactive dialogue. As the United Nations, like ESCAP is probably the oldest United Nations institution in the Asia Pacific region. We were created immediately after World War II and represent the 53 countries in the whole Asia Pacific. As a regional arm, like, we do like three main activities for ESCAP. The first is that in intergovernmental coordination, we are probably the most broad-based intergovernmental platform for policy coordination and discussions in the region. And second, that we do policy research, which is to follow up on the economic and social development in this region and provide reports to our member states. So that's the economic and social survey is our flagship publication on that front. And third, that we also do capacity building on various development fields that can benefit the country. Own effective pursuit of the sustainable development. So I really like this opportunity to not only present what we are doing, but also listen to colleagues from the ideas and from other local experts that value your thinking on the real view on development issues in this region, and also financial development in this region, and also how that an international organization like ESCAP can better collaborate with local think tanks and work with the local policymakers to really help the people in this region. So can I quickly move on to the economic social survey 2018. So I will first introduce the macroeconomic trends and like of the survey, and then I will move on to talk about some of other initiatives like our activities on financial development in general. So first, what is the general growth trend in this region for 2017 up to early 2018? So we can see from the first chart on the left. From the first chart on the left, that's the growth trend the picked up in 2017. Like from in general, on average, the region registered good growth rate for 2017, from 5.4 in 2016 and grow to 5.8% of the economic growth in 2017. So this is the strong, relatively strong growth performance is fueled by both external and internal drivers. Externally, that we observe a general recovery of the global economy after the global financial and economic crisis of 2008-2009. The performance of the economic performance in US, Europe, and also in this region in Japan have been relatively strong in 2017, so which created the demand for export and for economic opportunities for countries in this region. And second is that also domestic policies and the consumption growth in countries of this region also have to drive this relatively strong growth performance in 2017. As you can see in the chart on the left, that the Asia-Pacific region is leading economic growth globally. The growth rate is far exceeding the other regions worldwide. Like in the recent years, Asia Pacific accounted for about 60% of the international growth every year. The Asia Pacific economic performance does matter globally, and we have strong implications. However, while the general trend is relatively positive for 2017, there are different drivers behind this growth trend across different sub-regions. So in ESCAP, we have five different sub-regions: East and Northeast Asia, North and Central Asia, the Pacific Islands region, and South Asia and Southeast Asia. So in East Asia, the economic performance picked up from 2016, and mainly driven by domestic growth, export, and also the recovery of the Japan. And in North and Central Asia, there was a big improvement in terms of economic performance, and that's mainly due to the recovery of Russia from its economic crisis, and also the change in the oil price, which is favorable for the mainly resource exporting countries in that sub-region. And the Pacific Islands, the economic driver, mainly tourism and agriculture, and export in certain manufacturing areas. And in South and Southwest Asia is the only sub-region which suffered a slight setback in terms of economic growth, and that was mainly due to India and Sri Lanka. So in India, the tax reform introduced on the general services tax did have some negative short-term impact. Well, the long-term impact, in March, people feel that the long-term impact of this tax reform will be good for the robustness of India's growth in the future, but the short-term impact has been felt in 2017. And then now the last is Southeast Asia, this region, sub-region. So in Southeast Asia, the economic performance has been exceeding expectations. It's driven by mainly two reasons. The first is still external demand and export opportunities for this region. Several countries did particularly well. So including Vietnam, Cambodia, and Myanmar. So in the sub-region, substantially exceeded the expectations in terms of growth. And also the local demand and also the investment and the credit boom also helped to drive this strong growth performance in Southeast Asia. So now we come to the general factors behind this trend.
Yeah.
The first is the trade development. You can see from the chart on the left that global trade patterns, both import and export, after like 2 years of weak performance, picked up in 2017 significantly, which that also helped the Asia Pacific, especially the Southeast Asian region, which deeply integrated into the global trade and value chains. However, this the trade performance and the, has a certain number of uncertainties like coming into 2018. So in the short term, we do see in our survey that several negative factors that may affect the trade performance, and also some positive potentials. So on the negative side, I think that there are three main things we worry about. The first is that the explosive internet, the global trade growth after China's joining of the WTO may not be replicated again. So between 2008, there has been strong global growth in trade, and China has been the kind of a center of that growth trend. After 2008, although despite this global efforts to keep the growth of the trade pattern trend going on, that kind of a very high growth rate of international trade may not be replicated in the future. The second is about this trade, like increasing like trade obstacles, as we see in this region. Between 2014 and 2017, we estimate that for each liberalizing trade measures in the Asia Pacific region, at the same time, there were on average 3.7 restrictive measures were adopted. So these are mainly non-tariff measures, which are hard to control, but at the same time, quite detrimental to the trade the performance in this region. And the third thing is obviously elephant in the room, which is the ongoing trade war, which is now starting to materialize. So when we draft the report, the trade war was a dark cloud hanging over our head, but now it has already materialized. So it's hard to predict that how this will play out, but for sure that this will have profound implications for this sub-region. So countries in Asia Pacific as a whole, and also especially in Southeast Asia, needs to be prepared for the uncertainties that's coming with this growing trade war, and needs to keep certain space in monetary and fiscal policies for contingency. But at the same time, we just also see there are some positive factors behind the trade in this region. The first is that we do see a growing domestic demand from China. So China is now in the process of transforming from a country depending on investment and external demand for growth to a country mainly whose growth is mainly driven by internal demand, domestic demand, and innovation. So if that kind of transformation will continue and will be successful, that it's likely to see that China now being a large importer of intermediary products for processing and export again to a demander for consumption, like final consumption products in the future. And also like several countries of this region also benefited significantly from the tourism from China. So this is a positive factor like in terms of export potentials, like expectation for countries in this region. And second is that there's substantial scope for greater trade integration in South Asian countries. So South Asia is very different from East and Southeast Asia. They are not yet like fully integrated into the global value chains, and their large like quantity of labor and resources and market are not yet fully tapped. So if there's chance that the South Asia and East Asia could further integrate and expand the total overall market size and enjoy the economic scale, we do think that this would be good potential for the Asia-Pacific region as a whole. And last but not least, we do see also technological progress is right, like promoting trade performance in this region, like through the e-commerce, online-based trading, the simplification of customs clearance using technological platforms. This may promote a future growth in trade. So, along with trade factors, domestic consumption and also investment have also been the main drivers behind the economic performance in this region. The domestic consumption has been fueled by the low inflation in this region in general, and the ease of borrowing because of the low interest rate, and also backed by a relatively stable labor market and strong labor, like growing labor income in several countries. However, a sustained increase in consumption, this consumption trend, needs to be backed by sustained, consistent real wage growth, which in turn is depending on productivity growth. So that means that we need productivity growth in the country so that the consumption improvement could be sustainable in the long run. And the one way to achieve that is to ensure that the consumption growth is inclusive. So it benefits not only a small proportion of the population, but the broader, especially the relatively poor groups of the whole population, so that they can effectively participate and contribute to the economic activities in the country and sustain this growth trend. As we can see, Asia Pacific has a mixed performance in that. So the chart on the left indicates the dots indicates the consumption by the bottom 40% in each country. So the vertical axis indicates the gross consumption growth rate compared to the national average. So if it's below the one, that means that the consumption growth of the bottom 40% is lower than the national average. If it's above the one, like the horizontal line, it means that it's growing faster. So if a country, the bottom 40% growth, the consumption is growing at a lower rate than national average, which means that the consumption inequality is widening. So we can see from this that half of the countries in this region, the relative economic position of the bottom 40% is deteriorating because they have an even lower growth rate in their consumption compared to the national average. So that's one area that, as you and we do think, it's urgent and necessary for countries to improve and to close or at least control the widening inequality gaps. And then coming on to investment. So investment has also been relatively strong in this region, which is a main driver for economic growth, which is also recovered after the stagnation of investment performance in the past several years after the crisis. However, the question is that what is, the long-run stability of this investment recovery? There are several factors that may affect this. It really depends on the aggregate demand, the cost of capital, the financial development, the trade openness, the macroeconomic stability, and also regulatory measures. But at the end of the day, the sustainability of investment really depends on the efficiency and effectiveness of investment in supporting productivity growth and supporting front, our recommendation is that the countries in this region should scale up the investment that are directly linked to the sustainable development agenda. So as you may know, that the international community adopted the sustainable development agenda, the 2030 agenda for sustainable development in 2015, which charted out the ambitions for 2030, and which has a very strong emphasis on inclusiveness, that is leaving no one behind. So we do think that the investment can be adjusted and focus more on creating economic opportunities for the disadvantages and poor people, and ensure economic, social, and environmental sustainability. It will benefit the future outlook for growth and development in countries of the region. So we have just discussed the contours of the economic performance of this region. So what are the policy measures? In terms of the monetary and financial policies, we do observe that the most countries in this region have adopted expansionary monetary policy since the crisis as a countercyclical measures. And in 2017, due to the low and stable inflation in most countries, and also the continuing capital inflow, so countries in the region still mostly maintain this expansionary monetary policy. And several countries like Russia, India, Indonesia, and Vietnam even decreased the policy rate in 2017. However, we do feel that the normalization of monetary policy in this region, also globally, would be inevitable. So it will come, but probably at a different pace. In the developed world, I think the normalization of monetary policy is already coming with interest rate hikes in the United States, as you can see in the charts on the left. So this will create the pressure on the financial the external balances of the countries in this region, and also the global capital movement, which in turn put a pressure on monetary policy to be more conservative and cautious. So the second chart on the right shows the private non-financial sector debt in the region, the aggregated debt. So the debt expansion and investment expansion has been driven the economies in several countries of this region. And again, that we do have concerns over the stability of the overall financial system in economies of the region after a period of expansionary monetary and financial policies. So most importantly, the rise in the corporate and household debt may not indicate like strong private investment in productive activities. For example, like in Thailand, much of the private sector debt is driven by the booming real estate market. So that's not investment in productive activities, but investment in stationary assets. Same thing in China, that's a large proportion of the monetary expansion, the additional liquidity created by the central bank and the banks actually went into the real estate market and stayed there rather than contributing to the real economy. Like China is, again, for instance, that a large proportion of this corporate debt is actually driven by the local government borrowing vehicles. So they are actually funding government expenditure rather than funding private investment. So these kind of patterns that we observe, and also the some indications that there may be a decreasing efficiency in the investment booms in this region to drive growth and drive employment, generates certain concern. So we do expect that due to external and internal pressures that the monetary, expansionary monetary policies in this region may need to be changed in the following years. So feel that the focus of the fiscal policy should gradually shift to more long-term objectives, such as improving the overall economic efficiency, support productivity growth, again, and support economic upgrading, and contribute to social and environmental development. At the same time these expansionary fiscal measures has created an increase in public debt. Well, in general, we still feel that the public debt issue in this region for most countries is still manageable. Actually, the recent analysis by IMF and World Bank suggests that 22 out of the 41 countries they have surveyed in this region have relatively low risk in terms of public debt sustainability. So we do feel there's still a fiscal policy space in terms of fiscal policy, but at the same time, we don't think the fast expansion of fiscal investment or spending would be likely in the coming years. So again, that means that the fiscal policy needs to focus more on long-term factors rather than short-term counter-cyclical measures. But one chance is that because we do expect the monetary policy to be tightening in the coming years, so there may be necessity for fiscal policies to jump in and offset some of the negative impact of tightening monetary policies so that it will not disrupt the overall economy. So one way to save money and achieve better results is to improve the efficiency of public spending. So the chart on the left is an estimation of the expenditure efficiency in education and health in this region. In particular, like for instance, we estimate that Pakistan could achieve similar levels of educational attainment using only 30% less budget compared to these recent peers. So which means that they can probably achieve the same result with only 70% of what they're spending now. So there's a significant margin for efficiency improvement. This of course is a one extreme case, but we do think that there's broadly a scope for more efficient public spending and more efficient investment in this region to achieve similar development results with the same or even less investment and spending needs. So what are the key messages taking out of this broad analysis? The first is that we do think the economic growth in this region will be steady and will remain steady. We project that in 2018 and 2019, the average growth in this region will be 5.5%. So it is slightly higher than 5.4 in 2016, but slightly lower than 5.8 in 2017. So the monetary and financial policies should focus more on macro financial stability now, given the accumulating of debt issues in several countries, private debt and also accepted public debt, and also because of external pressure from the interest rate hikes in the U.S. and other developed regions. But at the same time, the fiscal policies should also focus more on the long-term effects. That is the productivity and reducing inequality. However, in view of the emerging challenges, like trade challenges we have mentioned already, the tightening monetary policy that we have anticipated, that there is a need for monetary policy and fiscal policy to collaborate better together in a coherent manner to offset the short-term impacts of some of the external shocks that we expect, and also some of the internal policy changes that we expect. So one of the interesting things that I noticed, for example, is the public debate between the Central Bank of China and also the Finance Ministry of China. Basically, the Central Bank is instructed to push forward this deleveraging as the accumulation of private debt and corporate debt in China. But they found that actually, so ideal situation is that when central bank is adopting a tightening policy, the finance ministry can go for more proactive fiscal measures to offset some of the negative impact. But what the Central Bank of China found was that while they are trying to promote leveraging, this public revenue has actually increased, so which means it's probably crowding out some of the liquidity available to the private sector and investment. And at the same time, also that the public debt level did not change or even slightly decreased. So I think this is something that we are still debating, but this is an indication that in these difficult times, it's important for monetary policies and fiscal policies to coordinate with each other and work together to address the common challenge they face, rather than like going on an independent separate track. So the communication will be important. And fourth, that Asia Pacific countries should take advantage of the relatively steady economic performance now. There may, of course, the certain risks are we can see are growing, but we still feel that it's a short window for relatively stable economic condition for countries to push for like their long term agenda, like the investment in long term factors and push for policies that's really inclusive and benefits everybody, and also address environmental challenges. So the last message that we're considering the various policies, the diversity of the economies must be taken into account, and also specific circumstances of countries with specific needs should be considered. So that means that when we say that in general, countries should invest in sustainable development, that means in education, healthcare, environmental protection, so on and so forth. But which one to prioritize will pretty much hinge upon the local context of individual countries and also their own priorities. So that's it for the way. I don't think I will have enough time to move on to this other research in ESCAP. I'll quickly probably bounce a little bit. So this is basically the broad contour about what ESCAP is doing on financing for development in general. So we have three thematic areas, which is domestic resource mobilization and public finance. So tax issues will come into this, and we have just discussed briefly before this the seminar with the PIDS colleagues regarding a potential collaboration on the city finance, issue at the local and sub-national level. And then the second topic is on infrastructure investment and PPP. So on this area, we have a relatively mature capacity building capacity. And we recently started in collaboration with the government of China, started this Asia Pacific PPP network. So it's a network of all the semi-governmental PPP think tanks and institutions for more effective collaboration and knowledge sharing in this region. I think the PPP Center for Philippines is already part of the program. And the third area is financial inclusion and SME finance. So that is to ensure that the financial services and the access to finance can benefit everybody, including the poor people and people in remote areas, and also benefits the SME entities that generates a lot of employment in this region. In terms of format of work, we use again three types. The first is that regional dialogue and intergovernmental coordination. So as I mentioned, ESCAP is the most broad-based intergovernmental platform under the UN system in this region. So this is one key area that we support. Second is the policy research and advocate studies. So I brought five copies of this book on tax policy for sustainable development, which we commissioned in published this year. Just as an example of the type of research that we do. And last is the capacity building. So currently, we're thinking of the Spain on PDG area, but we are also planning for a project this year on city finance. So that's it. Yeah. Thank you very much.
thanks, Wayne. All right, so from that regional perspective, we'll have a presentation that narrowly focuses on the Philippines, but it will look at the long term. Long term here, meaning up to 2030, which is the Sustainable Development Goals. Actually, that might be one of the issues I might raise later in your presentation. Development, what is that development? In an earlier round of studies by UN, I think it was MDGs.
Yeah.
So if we can look forward to SDGs. But anyway, then that's jumping ahead of the story. All right, so I'm more excited to see the open, to hear the open forum than listen to my own presentation. Okay, so here we go. Just a caveat, this was not really intended for a long-term outlook. This was really, this study was really designed to analyze implications of productivity growth in agriculture in the context of the entire economy. So, Philippines is inspired to achieve 7 to 8% growth. Okay, that's its aspiration. All the way up to 2040, so 2030 is the horizon for the Sustainable Development Goals. For the Philippines on what they call the ambition 2040, it's up to, ambition, it's up to 2040. Within that period, well, actually within this current administration, the idea is for per capita GDP to rise 41% and eventually hit upper middle income status of about $5,000. This will be just, you know, approaching that of Thailand in 2015. And then the ambition also is for poverty to decline, most rapid ever. This has never happened, this pace of poverty reduction that they're ambitioning, 2015 to 2020, simply has not occurred in the history of poverty reduction in the country. Sorry, I'm getting out of the, all right. I should be here. But yeah, actually there are many perspectives to look at the slides. So 14%, that is the objective by 2022. So if this administration didn't reach 2022, they should be kicked out. No, it's already over. Anyway, so I'm focusing on agriculture because, well, not because it's a big contributor to GDP. By no means. In fact, it's only even less than 9% by 2016. It's a bit of a concern because it's still a big employer of workers, 29%, far disproportionate to its share in output. And in fact, in 2015, 62.4% of all poor workers in the country are working primarily in agriculture. So, as I mentioned, we might not be looking at agriculture for growth because of this, right? Okay, sorry. Yeah, TV does not
show the pointer.
But we were not looking for agriculture for growth in terms of output, but inclusive growth, certainly, agriculture matters. In fact, perhaps it's safe to say that if you have a program of inclusive growth, allegedly, and you miss out on agriculture, you're missing out on the poor, because they're mostly still there. Now, unfortunately, despite the fact that it is so, the sector is so critical for inclusive growth, growth of agriculture is very slow relative to the rest of the economy. So we're impressed by the overall economic growth of Philippines. Philippines is one of the leaders in the Southeast Asia growth that was shown in an earlier slide. That is actually mostly industry and services. Agriculture has grown only 2% over that period, 2011 to 2016. Now, up to 2012, agricultural wages were actually growing very slowly. But fortunately, since that time, it has picked up to 3% in real terms every year. One reason why agriculture has grown so slowly is it is buffeted by shocks. Since 2015 to 2016, it was struck by a very severe El Nino. So 2017, its growth was 4%, so it will drive this up, the 2% up, but that's mainly because it's recovering from the El Nino of 2015 to 2016. All right. Maybe when I developed this paper, I was being too enthusiastic, maybe. So I said that if you look at the sources of growth, maybe one is stabilizing the economy. For many, many years, the Philippines had contended, decades, with macroeconomic stability, stable prices, stable GDP growth. And since around 2000, prices have been fairly stable. And since around 2010, growth has been high and relatively stable. So perhaps we might say that because of fiscal balance, the continued pursuit of fiscal balance and money restraint in terms of inflation targeting, I was bold enough to say that maybe the problem of short-term stabilization has been solved. I'm not saying that we should just be complacent, it's done. No, we should protect the gains we've already made, but then we should move on, right? We should move on to what can push that growth further. It's still 6%. Maybe an extra 1% or 2% will get us to our goals faster. So in the long run, what you really need for growth is growth in your resources, mainly your labor, your capital, so capital accumulation. But really, the essence of that growth, the big oomph, as we would say, for growth will have to come from technological change or technical progress. Now, we measure technical progress because it's a very vague concept, using a fairly technical measure, what we call total factor productivity growth. Essentially, this means that we measure growth, then we account for what growth can be attributed by growth in your resources, and then the excess, the unattributed factor, the residual, that's what we attribute to technological change. Oops. So, this particular study looks at what happens at alternative scenarios of that technological change. So the growth of resources, the growth of capital in the model is already provided, it's already given, but what we play around with is differences in growth of total factor productivity. The reference scenario, so the baseline as it were, is to look at productivity trends since about 2010, the period of accelerated growth, and say, what happens if those are projected forward? Are those enough to achieve the growth targets of PDP 2017 to 2022? Then since this is an agriculture-based study, we put in a little bit of sub-reference scenario. What if we put in a lot of capital subsidy in agriculture as part of that, as a program for accelerating growth in output in agriculture. The next scenario is, suppose we accelerate productivity growth above trend in agriculture to match that of industry and services. The next is, suppose there's a problem because of continued climate change, we cannot anticipate, agriculture is buffeted by more unfortunate episodes in climate change. And finally, accelerated growth in industry and services. Could, of course, obviously, even without looking at the model, that will accelerate growth of the economy as a whole. What will be the impacts on agriculture? Will that also pull up productive growth in agriculture? So these are the scenarios we looked at. And these are the assumptions. You have these negative numbers for 2014 to 2016 because these are the past. And these are the numbers chosen, and I will show you later, that will, if you input these numbers in the model, they will replicate more or less the actual growth performance of agriculture. 2017 and then 2018 to 2030, these are the actual, well, when I did this study at that point, was still actual projections. Look, 1%, quite low. If you look at industry, it's 1.5 to 2% and up to 2.5% up to 2030. Services, similar, but somewhat faster. Now, these, I say, are comparable to estimates of TFP from the literature. The Federal Reserve of Louisiana, I believe, yeah. They came up with TFP estimates for the whole world by country, and their estimate for the Philippines was 2.8%. So since most of the economy is anyway industry and services, this is quite close to the numbers we're imputing up to 2030. A local study by ABA et al., interestingly, ABA probably had no idea about the Federal Reserve study, but they came up with fairly similar estimates of 2.4% for total factor productivity growth. So I think the 2.5 is a good enough compromise for the long-term projection. Here's what I said, that when we look at the official data on 2014 to 2015, we don't get, of course, an exact match, but it's fairly close, okay, at least for agriculture, even for industry and services. So now we look at the projection moving forward. The projection is there in 2017 to 2030. Overall for GDP, 6.91%. So it's not quite 7 to 8%, but it's getting there. If you round it up, yeah, it's a rounding error. It's 7%, right? If you just expect TFP to grow a trend, even at fairly high levels for industry and services and fairly low levels for agriculture. And agriculture will grow at around 2%. No? So 1% trend TFP growth translates to about 2% overall agricultural GVA growth. That's what the model presents. So we looked at the other scenarios. If productive agriculture scenario, industry and services TFP is the same, but we accept that we bumped up productivity growth in agriculture to 2.5%, the same as industry and services, versus 1% in the reference scenario. For climate change, we eliminated and said, oh, because of repeated climate change issues in agriculture, you don't expect any productivity growth at all up to 2030 net. And finally, with productive industry and services, we bumped this up from 2.5 to 3%. Why only 3%? Actually, the model suggests that if you bump this up much further, the growth rate will actually hit close to China standards, which might be okay, right? But perhaps a bit unrealistic. So I'll stick with the 3%. Might be a critique of the model. Anyway, so we're looking now at the growth trends up to 2029. A while ago, I just showed the overall average, but this is again repeating the reference scenario, but you can see the trends. And I also sneak in here the agricultural subsidy scenario. So when you subsidize capital in agriculture, it turns out that overall growth slows down very slightly by 0.01%. So this might be good for agriculture, and we'll show that in a while, but that's bad for the economy as a whole. The policy of subsidizing capital in agriculture. Now, if you have a productive agriculture, overall growth bumps up to 7.03%. Obviously, because the rest of the economy is growing with the same TFP rate, but agriculture grows faster. So that will definitely bring you into the PDP growth target territory of 7%. With climate change, it's going to bring you farther away, but not much farther away. Even with zero productivity growth in agriculture, overall GDP growth will still be at about 6.8%. Still, when you round it off, it's 7%. Of course, when you have productive industry services, just a 0.5% bump in the TFP growth of industry and services is enough to push your overall GDP growth to be a sustained level on average of 8.1%. Quite above the on the top half of the PDP growth target of 8%. So actually, yeah, you can guess that when I experimented with even higher rates, say 3.5%, I was getting something like 9 or 10%. I said, okay, this is going to strain the credulity of my attentive audience right now. So I'll just make it a bit more conservative. Okay, so that's the summary. Now, focusing more narrowly on, so this is overall, right? Focusing more narrowly on agricultural GVA, and we already showed that number, 1.98. Indeed, when you have subsidies for agriculture, it accelerates to 2.32% growth, which is fine. So you might have to weigh the fact that, well, a lot of your poor workers are in agriculture, maybe we should promote that, versus a slightly slower growth of GDP as a whole. When, of course, if instead of subsidies on capital, you make agriculture itself more productive. The impact is much greater. It will grow by almost 4% per annum. With climate change, of course, its growth is not completely suppressed. It will not grow by zero, despite zero TFP growth, but it will be close to zero, or closer to 1%. And finally, even with productive industry services, actually, this is what surprised me a bit. I thought that because of linkages, growth in agriculture will be faster. The model suggests that growth in agriculture will be slower when TFP industry and services accelerates, TFP growth accelerates, mainly because resources are being pulled out of agriculture faster to serve the requirements of the faster growing industry and services. All right, so for industry GVA, the reference scenario, growing fairly fast, 8%, similar to its trend in 2010 to 2015. Slightly slower under a subsidy to agricultural scenario, but hardly matters. With productive agriculture, it's slightly improved because of linkages with, say, food and beverage manufacturing, but hardly any change, actually. Nor is it, well, if there's hardly no impact from improved agriculture, then also there's hardly any adverse impact from adverse climate change scenario for agriculture. But with productive industry services, accelerating TFP by just 0.5% will bump up its GDP growth, GVA growth, to 9.69, almost 10% per year. For services, similar story, of course, a bit lower, given its lower growth trajectory than industry, but more or less following the same story as industry. Right, for wages, the reference scenario suggests that within agriculture, growth will stay around the 4 to 3% level, slowing down up to 2030. And those trends will be affected somewhat by a more productive agriculture, will bump up the agricultural wage growth. But with climate change, will be suppressed, the agricultural wage growth. With productive industry services, yes, that will have at least there's some impact of cross-sectoral impact. The agricultural wage will be boosted, which is not surprising, right? Because resources are being pulled out of agriculture, which means because of supply and demand, because of reduced supply of workers in agriculture, wages will be driven up. So that's the extent of the interaction that's being observed there. Meanwhile, here are the trends for the industry and services wage. Wow, these are a lot of numbers. Let's go straight to the conclusion. All right, so sustaining productivity growth, a trend, 2010, so it's not, I picked up a number out of the air and said, oh, okay, suppose productivity, no. These are confirmed empirical estimates within the ballpark of those that I cited earlier. So between 2.4 and 2.8, I selected 2.5 for industry and services, no? And one for agriculture. Just adhering to the trend, we will reach the close to the 7% target in the Philippine Development Plan. If TFP growth in agriculture is weak, as it has been in 2010 to 2016, then it will continue to be weak up to 2030. Input subsidies, say capital subsidies, which is being contemplated now by the Department of Agriculture, there's a thrust stated earlier by the Secretary of Agriculture that they want to do away with all sorts of subsidies in agriculture and replace it with cheaper loans and subsidized interest rates. So the scenario for that is, yes, that could boost overall GVA growth in agriculture, but it will impose a cost on the rest of the economy. Agricultural wages will continue to rise, but wage disparity continues to widen. So let me scroll back here. So here you can see that despite the fact that this is fairly rapid, this is even more rapid here. So instead of convergence over time, wages in agriculture and industry services will diverge perpetually until 2030. Interestingly, the latest World Bank study, when I did this, I didn't have the benefit of that study, but the latest World Bank study assessing poverty, they attributed the biggest gain of the from the 25 to 21% drop in poverty from 2012 to 2015. They attributed the biggest share of that to the movement, to the structural change, to the movement of households from being primarily primary occupation in agriculture to primary occupation outside of agriculture. That was the main. The second one was rise in wages in agriculture. All right? So despite, you know, what you're hearing, oh, agriculture is dying, the young people are no longer, that's the key to poverty reduction, actually, the movement of workers and employment outside of agriculture. That's what the numbers are saying. Of course, we shouldn't dismiss the potential impact of that on food security, but at the same time, we have to recognize that, yes, the structural change is one key to poverty reduction. So, sorry, that was my soapbox. Moving on. Productivity in agriculture impacts strongly on agriculture itself, but not much on the rest of the economy. So it's like an enclave by itself. And the industry services are an enclave by themselves. That's the next point. So I was expecting that there will be indirect impacts. No, the model suggests not. So there's something in the input-output relationships of these sectors that defeats this expectation. So the analysis suggests that we should aim for accelerating growth in TFP through the usual instruments, research and development, innovation, adoption of technology, improved practices and systems, investment in public goods, not really, say, subsidies or implicit transfers by making credit cheaper that end up, it improves, it expands agricultural output, but really has no long-term impact on productivity per se in the sector. There is a potential case for strengthening agricultural value chains. So you could interpret, there are no linkages, never mind about those linkages. Just boost industry and services. But you could flip it around and say, hey, we have a problem. There are not enough linkages. If we could just leverage that industry and services growth for agriculture by stronger value chains linkages, then growth could be in agriculture could be pulled up better by the ongoing growth in industry and services, which are accounting for 92% of the GDP. So perhaps, say, food manufacturing based on, so we have chocolates. A lot of our chocolates are not being made with domestically produced cacao. Our cacao is being exported. Rubber manufacturing. Well, I understand DTI has been making significant changes recently, but for the longest time, rubber manufacturing in the Philippines, we have some of the biggest tennis ball making factories in the Philippines. But a lot of them were not growing much of their rubber raw material from the Philippines, whereas the Philippines is a major producer of crude rubber. So our crude rubber is being exported abroad. The problem is the crude rubber we produce is of lower grade than the raw material requirements of these rubber manufacturers. So they import higher quality from abroad, and ours is exported to other countries here. So if we could connect local value chains, this is also a discussion in mining, right? Well, why are we just sending our raw ore abroad and then import back the fabricated stuff where the value added is now higher? Can we not produce those things here? That's not really agriculture, but that's the same principle. Can we have a bit more linkages between the raw material production and the downstream higher value added processing? So, okay. So those were the messages from that study. Thank you.
Thank you so much, Dr. Briones. I know that you're excited for the open forum, but let me suspend that just for a while. Let's take a 10-minute break.
Okay.
Please queue for your snacks outside. Time check is 2:40, so be back at 2:50 for the open forum. Thank you.
So,
number one bias.